Welcome to Unapologetically Sensitive, where you can learn, relate, laugh, and maybe even live a bolder, brighter life. I'm your host, Patricia Young. This is a weekly podcast where we explore the strengths we have because of our sensitivity and some of the challenges it poses as well. The information in this podcast is not a substitute for help from a licensed mental health professional. Hey there. To the creatives, healers, sensitives, and deep thinkers, how are y'all doing? How are you managing now that the weather's changing and maybe some of the snow is melting depending on where you live? How you doing? This episode today with Anni Furniss, I really enjoyed talking with Anni, and I first met Anni through her husband, John Furniss, the blind woodsman, who was on episode 97. And Anni and I corresponded a little bit back and forth, and we connect via TikTok. And I had asked her to be a guest, and it was really nice just getting a chance to get to know her today. And then we had a little chance to talk before and after. This episode is really great. It's much more of an informal conversation. I guess all my conversations are informal. But Anni talks about feeling awkward and how she uses her vulnerability to soften communication with John, her husband. She talks about some of the challenges of being a highly sensitive person, the corresponding strengths. I ask her, what would you want to tell your younger self about being a highly sensitive person? We do a lot of discussion about friendships, and I think expectations that we as HSPs have around our friendships. I think it's just a really valuable episode, and I love how honest and candid Anni is. If you can get through the first 5 minutes of this recording, there's some static on Annie's end. And once I realized that the static was there, we switched to another platform. I don't know how it's going to read post-production, but it is a little bit noisy. I tried to clean it up, so then you hear static and then there's quiet. I don't know how bad it is, but I just wanted to give you a heads up. But we do switch platforms, and I have listened to a little bit of the second recording and it sounds like it's okay, but I always like to give you a heads up when we have little audio stuff going on. If you have not signed up for my newsletter, I would love to have you on the newsletter. I send it out just once a month. It's kind of hard to tell you how to do it. The easiest thing to do is to go to my website at unapologeticallysensitive.com. There's a main banner that runs on the top part of every page, and it says to sign up for the 10 most downloaded episodes. If you do that, you will have an opportunity to subscribe to the newsletter. I think I need to update the website, but I don't want to chat about that too much. Let me tell you a little bit about Anni Furniss. Anni Furniss is a visual artist and an HSP. She thrives on finding new ways to navigate the world by adapting. She also has a physical degenerative disability, ADD, and anxiety. So she has a plethora of physical and neurodiversity. For over 20 years, she has used art as a healing outlet, and art is also her full-time job. She had a hard time working in conventional jobs, so she made her own. Her husband is totally blind and is a woodworker. We run our business together and make a great team. We live in the Pacific Northwest and have a fur kid named Pickle. I really would encourage you to look at Annie's artwork because she's just incredibly talented, and the videos that she and her husband make on TikTok or Instagram, Facebook, are just, they're short, they're charming. And now, on to the show. Hey, Anni, welcome.
Hi, thank you.
I'm glad to have you here.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
So we were both talking before we recorded that I'm really tired today and I'm not feeling super focused. How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm kind of having a rough day myself.
Yeah. Do you want to talk a little bit about what's going on? And then we can talk about, the reason why I wanted to talk about this is it's okay to show up when we're not 100%. And I think that when we think that we either have to be 100% or we can't show up, our life gets really small. So what's going on with you today?
Yeah. Well, recently I've been having more of chronic health problems. I've had chronic health problems for about 10 years or so, but recently they've gotten a lot worse. And I had to go to the hospital and I was diagnosed with a degenerative bone disease, and I've been having to get around with a walker. And so that's a new thing to adapt to. And I haven't been sleeping well and just been feeling not as clear-headed as I usually am.
And your walker has a name.
Yeah. Her name is Sheila and I've decorated her.
Yes. I love that. I love that. Let's take a step back. Do you identify as a highly sensitive person?
I do. And it took most of my life to identify as one, because I was actually told by a therapist when I was about, I think I was 17 or 18, and she told me that I was a highly sensitive person. I fought labels my whole life. I didn't want to be a label. I didn't want to be a sensitive person. And I am also very stubborn. And so I fought, you know, I was like, I have to be strong. And I thought there was something wrong with me for so long. In the last, like, I'd say year or two, I've been able to embrace that part of myself.
I find that either people have a real sense of relief when they find out about the trait, the sense of like, oh my gosh, there's nothing wrong with me. This is how I'm hardwired. Or people feel really like, no, I don't like this and I'm not going to accept it. And it's funny, right before we got on, there's a Facebook group for highly sensitive therapists, and there was a therapist just posted like, I just found out about the trait about 2 weeks ago and I'm not feeling it. And I get that. And I think it's really important that no matter what your response is, that you let it be okay. And if you don't like the label, or you don't want to be highly sensitive, or you're angry and resistant, that's really okay. That whatever feelings are going on for you, they're really, it's okay. And you don't have to like the label if you don't want to.
Yeah, I think it's important to give ourselves some grace in that way. I'm not good at that. I'm really not great at giving myself grace. I'm great at giving other people forgiveness and grace and love, but not myself. I think once I embraced that label of the highly sensitive person, and I sometimes get it mixed up with hypersensitivity, which I also have called myself. I don't really know the difference. Once I embraced that, I felt that sense of relief. And I started to care more about myself and think about myself in a little bit of a different light.
Yeah, I think many people can relate to it. So much easier to have compassion and empathy for other people, and to be able to learn to have that self-compassion is really hard. I wonder how much of that is about having wounding or trauma. And I didn't use it until recently, because there are so many different forms of whether we experienced childhood emotional neglect, or we had parents that were emotionally immature, or just parents that weren't available for us. I don't know, but I think we can use that tremendous amount of empathy that we have for others to learn how to cultivate that for ourselves.
Right. I agree. Yeah. I know. I think that I had heard the word trauma for a long time, and I've had some in my life that I definitely knew was trauma. But then there were some other parts, you know, like you were saying, growing up with parents that maybe didn't understand what I was going through and didn't know how to deal with, you know, maybe they didn't have the self-awareness themselves or done the healing themselves and know how to handle a child like me. Because I use this word, and I don't think it's the correct word to use now, but I was a, quote, difficult child. Meaning I was highly emotional, highly sensitive. I had a, quote, temper problem, but now I know it was, you know, I didn't know how to handle my emotions that were coming up. And I don't think my parents did either. And I do not fault them for it. They were very loving and they tried their best.
And that's not uncommon, because we have strong emotional responses to things. And again, no fault, no blame, but ideally, you'd want to have a parent that understands a child that has strong responses to things and can validate that and co-regulate with them and help them learn to manage it. But when we don't, we do get messages that we're being difficult or intense or dramatic, and then we internalize it and we think we're too much. And it's really about not having an environment or parents or caregivers that really got our trait and were able to understand. Hey, Anni.
Hello.
We had some technical problems and had to switch platforms, and this is just what happens. So we're just going to go with it.
It's just life. Exactly.
I actually had an interview with somebody on Monday that I really, really, really wanted to be on the podcast. We've been trying to schedule for months, and we just had technical problems. It was not on my end, and the guests decided that they didn't want to record and didn't want to be on the podcast. So I just surrendered and let it go.
Yeah, that's a bummer. Sometimes you just have to do that.
Yeah, you do. Let's talk a little bit about your relationship with your husband and what that's like and how you refer to your relationship.
Yeah, so John and I have been together for about 8.5 years, and he is totally blind. and we met in 2012. I was an artist painting a piano at the school for the blind. It was a piano school for the blind that he was attending. That's how we met. I think you had him on your podcast recently, so he probably told the story already.
He did. It's episode 97, yes. And it's called If You Can't See, Imagine with John Furniss.
He is an extraordinary person. I have never met anyone like John before. So he was a piano technician at the time, and now he's a woodworker. He transitioned out of that. Now he's a woodworker. But my relationship with him, it started out rather challenging because I had never been with anyone that was blind. I had never actually even been friends with anyone that was blind. And so there was a learning curve there on my part and his part too, because I think he was used to people, you know, like when he lived with his parents and his family, they knew how to adapt his environment for him. And I had to learn how to do that, being in a relationship with him. He is also an extremely patient person, and I am not. And I wouldn't say I'm not anymore, because I've really, really had to learn how to be patient. Broken dishes, things being knocked over, not to mention, and this is not related to his blindness, but he is forgetful. And that is a trait that my mom has. And so it was actually a really healing relationship to have, because I learned how to become patient and forgiving in that way. Anyway, he's a gentle and kind person, very funny. And different than any relationship I've ever had.
Well, it's interesting. I see the videos that you do on TikTok, and you're very, very sweet. And before we started recording, you needed to call him in the shop to find out where something was, and you had to communicate with him. And I'm like, you communicate the same way? Like, I thought, well, maybe that's just for show that...
No.
But that's how y'all communicate all the time.
Yep. Yeah. It is. Yeah. No, he answers the phone. Hey, sweetie. You know, I mean... Like I said, I've never been with anyone like him, and he is in touch with his compassionate side, and he's so nurturing. He has embraced that part of himself. And yeah, I've never been with a partner that has been able to do that.
Do you have people say to you, if you two are out in public, that tell you that you're an angel and how, you know, God's going to save you because you're so special for being with somebody who's blind?
Yeah. There was one time when we were in Fred Meyer, and this woman told me that I was an angel for being with him. And she said, thank you so much for helping him. And I said, you know, he helps me in ways that you probably wouldn't even know. I have severe anxiety disorder. And on top of being a highly sensitive person, that's something that he's helped me with, because he has faced his anxiety many, many times. I mean, he still struggles with it, but not nearly as much as I do. And so I've learned a lot of tools and coping mechanisms from him. And he also just is there for me when, you know, he's patient enough to know what I need in that moment. He doesn't lose patience with me, and he is very loving.
The first long-term serious relationship that I had, I didn't date in high school. I was a fat kid that nobody really wanted to be around. I was very kind, but did not date very much. And the first man that I had a long-term relationship with, Brian Finley, is a quadriplegic. And I remember going to Disneyland, and I'd have to lift him into a ride and out of a ride. And I remember people telling me, you know, bless my heart, bless you. It's like I earned my ticket to heaven. And I just, it was the same thing, that I had so much wounding, and this was the most healing relationship that really I felt so safe with him and really learned and did so much growing with this man who was incredibly patient. And I just had a lot of wounding. And I don't think that people understand sometimes that, you know, I'm not implying that relationships are like dogs, but, you know, we have rescue dogs, and people tell us that it's so nice that we rescued a dog, and oftentimes our dogs rescue us.
Without a doubt.
It's really, it's mutual healing. And I don't mean to imply that relationships are like dogs, but just that there's so much that we receive that people don't often see.
Yeah. And, you know, and sometimes what I say is, well, he's the angel, because I joke with him that he literally is an angel, because I don't know anyone like him. And, you know, I've never met such a kind person in my life.
Yeah. And all relationships are hard. So if we're talking about being with a highly sensitive person and a non-highly sensitive person, that's hard. Two non-highly sensitive people, one able-bodied and one or temporarily able-bodied, tab, or one disabled person, that relationships are just hard, and it's so easy to focus on the differences and attachment. Relationships are complicated. They're wonderful. And it doesn't matter what the dynamic is, there are always going to be challenges.
There always will be. And I think the willingness to put in the work is what makes it work. Because, you know, in my previous relationships, I think my biggest issue was communication, not telling the other person and how I was feeling. And I would just expect them to understand what was going on in my mind and to understand what I needed. And that it's not how it works. You have to let the person know what you need and what's important to you in a relationship. And so that's been a practice that we started doing that very early on. And one thing that I learned how to do was to say, this is uncomfortable. This feels so awkward. And when I said that, it just kind of, you know, like popped the balloon, and it relieved that tension because it is uncomfortable. So when there's something that feels not very great to talk about, we'll just say that. And it makes it a lot easier to talk about.
I think that willingness to be uncomfortable, it's such a random thing. I was in treatment for my eating disorder when I was 30, and I'm 57 now. And it's funny, when I was in the shower today, that we used to go to this place called Recovery Inc., which had kind of crazy sayings. And one of the sayings was, the willingness to bear discomfort brings comfort, and comfort is a want and not a need. I know it sounds crazy, and it's ironic that I was thinking about that today, but it's just what you're saying, that if we want to have intimacy, it means having to be awkward and uncomfortable and take those risks. So what happens when you name that sense of awkwardness or discomfort? What happens after that?
Well, you think that it has kind of a power over you, and it kind of does, because I feel like it freezes me. I can feel my face getting red. My chest gets tight, you know, and I'm almost stubborn, you know, like in a way, like I'm not going to share this information. And I don't know why I feel that way until then when I share it. Oh, okay. With that vulnerability, it just kind of releases that power that it has over me. And also I can see that my vulnerability kind of softens John too, you know, because say we're having a tense conversation, and, you know, the way to word it is, our wounds are touching each other, you know, because that's kind of what happens. And, you know, maybe we're feeling triggered or our buttons are being pushed. But then when I say something vulnerable, or he does, oh, okay, well, we can see the human in each other, and we can see that wound very clearly. And then there's room for compassion. And so that, oh, and so much growth happens out of that.
That is, it's so beautiful and so powerful and so simple and so hard.
It is. I know. Yeah. It's easy to say, but then when you're in the moment and you feel all of those, even that, those physical feelings that take over your body, it's hard to push through that.
Well, it's easy to get identified with the story in our head and clinging to that need to be right. And what I hear you saying is that the two of you are able to be really vulnerable in the moment and to say, I feel awkward, I don't know what to do. And when the other person can hear that and also drop the story, in that vulnerability is where that intimacy and connection is.
Yes, without a doubt. Yeah. And it's definitely took work. The first about 6 months of our relationship were very difficult for both of us, because we were used to being in these destructive relationships. We both had this pattern of choosing partners that also had, you know, a trauma story, but not doing the work. So when we met each other, you know, we both had these really intense backgrounds and things that we were, you know, working through. At one point we had made the decision to break up, and it was about 6 months into our relationship. And then we hung up. I remember we hung up, and I called him back and I said, I don't want to do that. And he said, neither do I. And we were just confused why we even made the decision to do that. And so at that point, we did a kind of a, made a strange decision to move in with each other. It seemed a little soon. However, for us, that actually is what brought us closer together. Integrating our lives like that was very healing for both of us.
Yeah. I don't think that people know that it's okay to talk about process. We get really stuck on content. And so the content can be, you didn't hear me. I asked you to do something, you didn't do it. And the process is, I feel really hurt when I ask you to do something and you don't do it. Based on my experience, I don't feel seen. I don't feel heard. And if the person comes back about, well, I forgot that you asked me, we're talking content. And if we go to process and somebody says, I hear that when I don't do what you ask me, or I forget that you feel like you don't matter to me. That is so important. And to be able to go into that place of, I don't know what to do. This is hard. I don't know how to resolve it. I know I'm committed to working it out and I'm angry and I don't know how to connect. When we can come from that place of talking about how we're feeling and not having the answers, the connection there is so sweet and so beautiful, and it's hard.
It is. You know, and I think that's even just like beyond romantic relationships. I think it's very important to do that in all of our relationships. And I have to admit, I am really terrible at doing that in friendships. I haven't really been great at honesty in friendships as far as my feelings go. I'm a people pleaser to the nth degree. And so I don't want to get uncomfortable, because friendships have a different type of intimacy than romantic relationships do. You're right in that, you know, sometimes that the vulnerability is where, you know, is where the real stuff is. It's where you become closer.
Yeah. I think it's harder to start having that intimacy in long-term relationships because often patterns have been established and there are lots of unspoken hurts. I'm not saying that you can't do it. You only want to do this with people that can reflect and have the same level of awareness that you do. In my newer relationships, I think of it in terms of almost, this isn't accurate, but I think of it as almost wanting to repel the people that aren't my people. So when things come up, it does feel scary because one of my primary wounds is not feeling seen and heard, or if I share about something that's important and I don't feel like somebody hears me, that it's a wound for me. And I really have been practicing sharing those things. And it's almost like a little, it's how we get safety. We do a little testing. So I'm going to let you know how I feel. And I'm going to see, are you going to be able to respond to me? And if you are, that's, I know the relationship can handle that. And the next time I might try a little bit more. Mm-hmm. And if you're not able to respond in a way where I feel seen and heard, I go, okay, so we're not going to go there in this relationship. And then I can either kind of what I call leveling down. And I don't mean that disrespectfully, but if I'm able to show up at a 10 with a full skill set and you can show up at a 6, then if I keep showing up at a 10, I'm going to be really frustrated about that 4 that is a difference for us. And so I need to meet you where you're at with your skill set at a 6. I mean, this makes it sound very, very simple, and it's relationships are complicated.
Oh, yeah.
But this has been a theme that has been going on. And I run a women's group and I've got 2 online HSP courses. And these wounds around friendship and intimacy, man, they run deep. And we don't talk about this enough.
I agree. And I really relate to what you're saying. I think that, you know, by establishing boundaries early on in a friendship, you're discovering how is that person going to respond with your honesty and your vulnerability, and is it safe to share these things? You know, I have old relationships. I don't know how else to word it, but longer relationships, you know, they had just kind of run their course. And I have lost friendships because of that, and because of not being honest, and maybe either I or the other person not being able to handle the honesty, because I know it was on my end too. But I really liked that idea of doing that early on in the friendship.
Yeah. And go ahead. I'm sorry.
Oh, and I was just going to say, and you know, even further saying further about the friendship thing, I don't have many friends. I have a lot of acquaintances and what I would call friendly people. I'm, you know, like we know each other and we like each other, but as far as an intimate friendship, I don't have many, and it's been a pattern throughout my entire life.
I don't think that you're really alone in that. And because I've done so much growing, I've really outgrown most of my long-term relationships, which makes me sad. I think we have this belief that if we are a good friend, we can maintain friendships for forever, as opposed to sometimes relationships come in and out of our lives and we have seasons for relationships, and it's okay that we grow and change. It's okay to find new relationships when the ones that we have aren't working for us. I'm not talking about attachment injuries where we get upset and we just move because we don't want to work it through, but I don't think we really get this message that it's okay to choose us. It's okay to find our people, especially as highly sensitive people. We have the ability to show up with such depth and intensity. And when we find somebody that can meet us in that place, it can be incredibly satisfying. And most of us have wounds. So are we able to navigate through that wounding and still continue to support the relationship?
Right. Yeah. I remember I had a friend who, I feel like maybe it was a test of our friendship, but you know, she had brought something up to me and it felt like she was trying to discover if I would be defensive in what she said. And I wasn't. And I mean, I could feel that could potentially come up, but I kind of basically asked her to clarify what she meant. And then we just had a nice conversation about it. And she was so surprised. And she said, "I'm really surprised you weren't defensive about that." And that was really refreshing. And so it's moments like that I really look for in friendships.
And as we do our healing and we start having relationships with people that are working on their wounding, I don't know that we ever finish working on it. It's an ongoing process. As we meet those people and we see what's possible, then we look at the other relationships where people do get defensive or they're not able to own their stuff or they don't show up in a way that is really meaningful to us. Then we go like, oh, there's something better out there. I wish I had a great analogy, but this is the only thing I can think of. It's like eating peanut butter and jelly all your life and thinking that that's all there is. And then you have a sumptuous gourmet meal and you go, oh my gosh, I had no idea that this was a possibility. Yeah. So then peanut butter and jelly may be good once in a while, but now that you know that there's all of this other stuff, what do you think you're going to want? But if you don't think all there is peanut butter and jelly, then that works.
Yeah. Some people like that comfort zone of peanut butter and jelly and they just want to live there and, you know, and I've been in that place too, where maybe I'm not ready for some gourmet food, but yeah.
Yeah. It's not a great analogy, but.
No, I understand though.
In a moment's notice.
I think you did good.
Is that Pickle?
No, actually it's a big truck outside. We live right on a busy street.
Okay.
And it was growling.
Okay. So that was the truck growling.
Yes.
I want to go into some of our highly sensitive person questions. So let me flip the page here.
Sounds good.
What are some challenges that you experience as a highly sensitive person? And then what we may do is look at the corresponding strengths.
I think one of the biggest challenges for me as a highly sensitive person is feeling overwhelmed easily. And I mean that in a very broad sense of the term. I mean that sensory-wise, so sounds, light, people, like amount of people, there's a big group. I become overwhelmed by tasks, you know, and sometimes I can't separate because I have ADD as well. So I have a hard time separating ADD and highly sensitive, the HSP, because a lot of the traits are very similar. But yeah, but I'd say, you know, that overwhelming feeling is pretty challenging for me to work through sometimes. It used to be, I would feel embarrassed about being so emotional. I'm not anymore. As I get older, I look at it as a gift. I think that it's a good thing that I can feel empathy towards, you know, situations and people. And you said, what are the gifts, you said?
What are the corresponding strengths, do you think, to those?
Strengths. Well, yeah, I guess I just answered that, the empathy. Yeah, I don't know why I'm having a hard time answering this one. I might have to go back to it, but
that's okay.
But yeah, that's all I can think of for right now.
Yeah, that's okay. I think the overwhelm is really, really common. I don't think that you're alone in that. And I'm looking for an expert. So if anybody's listening and you're an expert in ADD and HSP, I really want to tease them out. They both are forms of neurodivergence. And I've been getting a lot of questions about what are the differences and then even about being autistic, because those are all forms of neurodivergence. And I think that there's some crossover. And I wonder if many of the things that I've talked about aren't, for me, ADHD and not being an HSP, and I've been misrepresenting. Obviously, I didn't do it intentionally. But I think a lot of those, the time blindness of not having a sense of how much time something is taking, or knowing that I need to get something, I need to get a newsletter out by the 15th and today's the 14th, and I didn't realize that, oh, I need to get that done. All kinds of things that I think it would be helpful to know, is it HSP? Is it ADHD? I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then for a while, I wondered if I was on the autism spectrum because of how I view situations. I don't understand things. There'll be social situations or instructions I'm given, and they don't make sense to me logically. Like, and I don't know if that's just the way my brain works or not, but my therapist said that she doesn't think I'm, you know, I don't have enough of the traits to be.
Yeah. It could be an auditory processing disorder. I mean, I'm not diagnosing you. Mm-hmm. I've also had that thought too, because there are certain things where I feel like my brain sees situations like a computer, not with very much empathy. And I'm not saying that if you're autistic, you don't have empathy, but there's a way that I process information that's very, there is no empathy in it, because I'm just looking at the pieces that go on. And I thought one of my sons was autistic too. I think it'll be interesting, the more research that there is, maybe to find the people that can speak to it. I love TikTok. And one of the things that's really challenging is I see people really there. I see somebody who's very, very popular talking about being an empath, and they're really talking about the traits of being an HSP, but they're also talking about the wounded parts of being an HSP, and they have so many followers. And, you know, we do the best that we can. And I've given misinformation. I was just thinking about something that I've said in the past that I learned is not correct. And then I feel bad about that. So, you know, we're all human.
Oh, yes.
And we do the best
that
we can.
I've done it too. But... yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, and I think that, you know, you brought up that the wounds of HSP. And I was thinking about my nephew. He has Asperger's. And I remember when he was first diagnosed, I would have conversations with him, and he was fairly young when he was diagnosed, but I would have conversations with him about how many gifts that he had and how it was almost like he had, you know, some of the, like these superpowers. Cause I was trying to teach him that he had things that he could do that other people were not as gifted in, you know, and I know that's the same for everyone, but I wanted to help him see that it wasn't the end of the world. And I didn't want him to feel like he was being put in a box, you know, and it's, I've seen his struggle. He also has anxiety disorder. And so I think that's part of my family too. Most of my family members have that, and it's difficult to deal with, but.
Well, and I find for a number of HSPs that, and if you have anxiety, I'm not telling you that you don't. So I want to be very, very clear about that. I thought I had anxiety. I think I tend to run on the anxious side. I think that has more to do with my depth of processing and my anticipating things that could happen. I tend to be a worrier. My brain almost always goes to the worst case scenario when things happen. But because I know that it does now, I go like, oh, that's my catastrophic thinking. Isn't that interesting? And then I'm able to pull back. But I think without knowing what that was and having a name for it, then I would think like, oh my gosh, I'm so anxious. Or I'll tell my kids to be careful. And they go, I will. It's like, I'm your mom. I'm the worrier. Like, it just like that's how it is. And I think having that awareness can really help us reframe. And if you have anxiety and that's a label that works for you, I'm not telling you not to. The research does show that those HSPs that had difficult childhoods, which can just mean having a parent that didn't attune to you or wasn't available, or that we have higher rates of anxiety and depression. And I was diagnosed with both anxiety, depression, and ADHD. And as I learned more about the trait, I'm not sure how many of those labels I identify with, but I do experience some anxiousness, and I do have times when I have a lowered mood and experience some depression. So I find more freedom in understanding how I function as opposed to the label. And if the label works for people, I'm not telling you not to use the label.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and I didn't know that I I didn't call it anxiety for so long. It's been about 4 years since I've started using that word. I have anxiety that takes over my whole body, and I will have full-on panic attacks. Those are very rare anymore, thank goodness. But the anxiety attacks still happen. I'd say probably about every other week or so. And they affect my, you know, how my body feels. And sometimes I feel like I'm, you know, having some sort of like physical episode, like a medical event or something. And luckily, John and I have come up with some things that bring me back to reality, and I learn how to ground myself, and I have imagery I use and that sort of thing. So, I mean, I think it works for me to, you know, to acknowledge that, because I didn't for so long and I didn't know what it was. I just thought I would call myself crazy, and oh, that's just so damaging.
Yeah.
Because I've had people call me that in my life, and it was very, very hurtful, and it really stuck with me.
Sure.
So, yeah. So, I mean, I think in a way for me, it has been empowering.
Yeah. And I want to be clear that I'm not telling people to use a label. Don't use a label. I tend to not like labels, but learning that I was an HSP was a label that really resonated. So everybody gets to choose for themselves.
Yeah.
Are you comfortable sharing some of the ways that you ground when you're feeling anxious? So if people are listening, that they might have some more tools.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Something that I do is I'll take off my shoes. I'll take off my shoes and socks, and I will put my bare feet on the floor. It really helps me feel grounded, and it reminds my body that I'm still here, that I'm not floating away, and I have control over the situation and my body. I've even, like, in a full-blown panic attack, I've even actually gone outside and stood in the grass. And oh my gosh, that works like you wouldn't even believe. I mean, for me, it does. That's something I do. I'll smell something a scent that I like, maybe like orange or patchouli or something like that. There's this thing that I saw, I think it was like last year, I saw it on Facebook, where you choose 5 things to name in the room. And I'll do that. That helps as well, just to kind of bring me back to, you know, to myself and to reality. So those are just some things. Music is another one that helps.
I love those. Thanks for sharing.
Yeah, of course.
Can you remember something that somebody said to you around your traits that was unkind, and what you would want to say to them now?
Yeah, there's one that really sticks with me. A high school boyfriend, his mom, after we broke up, I was completely heartbroken. But not just heartbroken. I mean, I felt suicidal. I was, you know, it was pretty extreme, the feelings I was having. I couldn't get out of bed. And I remember his mom, and I don't know how I found this out, but his mom called me crazy. And I was a kid, you know, I was like 15 or 16, I think. And oh, that was so hurtful. And that really stuck with me. And I want to tell her, I mean, hey, I was a kid. You know, I was feeling some big feelings that I didn't know what to do with. I had really big attachment issues, and I didn't know what to do with them. You know, at that point, I hadn't started therapy yet. I'd say just try to have some compassion.
Yeah, that was a really hurtful thing to say.
Yeah.
I too have a ton of attachment injuries, and I come by them very honestly. I can remember being maybe my late 20s, early 30s, and I was dating a guy, and he would come and spend the weekends. And then when he would leave to go back to his house, my mom would come over and I would sob. I was almost re-experiencing trauma and loss from my past, and I would just come unglued, and it's what I needed to do. Mm-hmm. But I hear you with the attachment injuries.
Yeah. I like that you call them injuries instead of issues, because it brings more compassion and nurturing to the feeling.
Yeah. Well, our attachment systems are so primary to everything that we do in our lives. And many of us have a lot of attachment injuries. It's natural. And I think that if we don't look at our attachment injuries and how they impact our relationships, we're missing a pretty big piece. And mm-hmm. I'll tell you, the last year or two has been about looking at my attachment injuries. It's been so hard.
Yeah, I have one myself that is just major. And I know it's a major part of what I carry with me. You know, like I have this like weight, literally and figuratively, you know, that I carry with me. And I know that it's related to the attachment injury, you know, injuries from when I was younger.
Well, what I love is through working through this, I'm so able to name what goes on, and I've got enough people in my life that it's really okay. And it's funny, my son was down, he was visiting home and we went kayaking. And in the morning, the last time he was down and he was going to paddle with me, the first time he was ever going to paddle with me, he changed his mind. He didn't want to get up. And his brother happened to be home visiting too. And I asked if he wanted to go and he said no. And I was very disappointed. And then this last time he said he would paddle with me in the morning, and I woke him up and he's like, in 10 minutes. And I just had this thing of like, really? Because I was having a hard time going. And so I was really counting on him. And when we were on the water, he asked me about that. And I don't talk to my kids a lot about my history. I don't know why. It's not that I'm not open. I just think they don't want to hear about it. I don't know. But I said, you know, one of my really big wounds is about being really disappointed and let down, counting on people and not having them show up for me. Mm-hmm. And I think he had asked, like, did you think I was going to cancel on you? And I said, so that's a hard one for me. And it was really interesting. He said, yeah, he really understood that. And I often wonder if me not talking about my anxiety and things that I experience, if it wouldn't be more helpful, especially to one of them more so than the other, that I think they have some similar things that I go through. And like I said, it's not intentional that I don't talk about it, but I just thought it was interesting that he brought it up and it gave us a chance to talk about it.
Yeah. And I think that's important for parents to be able to share, you know, I mean, maybe when the, you know, your children are older, you know, and how old are your kids?
I have twins that are 20.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, I think that would have made a big difference for me if my mom shared more about what she went through.
Yeah.
I mean, I know more about it now, you know, I'm very close with my parents. They're really wonderful people, but they, you know, they didn't share those types of things with me growing up. I had them in one category, parents. And now that I'm older, I see that they're humans with very complicated feelings. And so I think that's really great for children to see that. And I think a lot of the time that happens when adult children have their own children, but I don't have children. And so it might have taken me longer to have that realization.
What would you want to tell your younger self about being a highly sensitive person?
I think I would say, I would want to say that there are more people like me out there than I could even imagine, and that I'm not alone, because that was the biggest thing for me, was feeling so alone and like such an outcast. I thought there was something wrong with me all the time. I thought everyone was better than me, you know, and I still have that story that goes on in my head, but I've been able to kind of overcome that quite a bit.
Yeah. Yeah. It's so easy. And I get caught up in this too, where I compare, that I pick one or two qualities or traits that somebody has and I think I want them. But then if I look at, if that meant losing my qualities and traits and taking on all the things that they have, it's like, no. But I think it's so common for us to pick and choose, yeah, and thinking that we can create a conglomerate of a person. But if it meant losing some of the things that I have, then no,
I know.
No, I think so.
Yeah. Yeah. And yeah, I'm so grateful that I have a partner that is able to see those things in me that I didn't like before. And I'm not saying that,
yeah,
you know, I'm not one of those people that believes, oh, John makes me mm-hmm. whole. You know, I think that he was able to show me the mirror that I needed to see.
Yeah.
You know, that to see those things in a different light.
When you were talking about overwhelm earlier, I wanted to respond and then I totally lost the thought and I just remembered what it was. So I just want to go back and share.
Sure.
I really relate to the overwhelm. And I was meeting with my business coach on Tuesday and there are some new tasks that I need to get done. And we were talking about them, but it was like that rabbit hole. Well, in order to do this, I need to do that. And then I need mm-hmm. to do that. And I need to do that, but I don't know how to do those things. So mm-hmm. even as we talked about it, I could feel myself just kind of like going, I can't do this. And it is so helpful when I have somebody that can hold space for me when I'm in that place without jumping in and trying to fix it. And by the end of our time together, we actually had worked through this stuff. And I was working on some of the projects today of things that I don't have time for it. I don't know how. I can't do it. And it goes back to what we started with, that there's so much power in naming where we're at and allowing that to be without trying to stop it or push it down, that then that it's, if we look at it as energy, it's just energy. And when we allow it, it moves and flows. And then oftentimes we get to where we need to be with it.
That's so true. Yeah, it is very true.
Yeah. Yeah. Anni, we're needing to wrap up. So I'm wondering, is there anything that I didn't ask you about that feels important for you to share?
Yeah. I mean, I just want to mention that I'm an artist and that art for me has been one of the biggest outlets in dealing with some of the challenges that I have. It helps me in my focusing issues. It helps me release emotions. It also helps me feel connected to people. Because, you know, I imagine my art going out to all of these different people and them seeing my art from their perspective. And I think that is so beautiful. And yeah, I just wanted to share that.
And I love your work. If you're on TikTok or Instagram, Anni and John do these beautiful little clips that are just, they're sweet, they're precious. I love seeing your work. I love seeing John's work.
Thank you. I'm so yeah. grateful to have been on here. Thank you.
Oh, where can people find you?
So I'm on Instagram under Anni Furniss Art. And also my husband and I have a website, Furniss Studios. It's just our last name and then studios.com.
And spell Furniss, please.
Sure. It's F as in Frank, U-R-N-I-S-S. And then from that website, you can find all of our social media. We're on TikTok and Facebook and Instagram.
Yeah, both of you have amazing art. And I will link to that in the show notes at unapologeticallysensitive.com. If you go to the podcast page and click on Annie's episode, or if you click on John's episode, both of them have probably the same links in them.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah. Anything else before we go?
No, I think that's it.
Well, thank you so much for being here today. It's really loved talking with you.
Yeah, it was really nice. Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye. Hey again. What'd you think of the episode? What are your thoughts about friendship? I found a friendship coach and invited her to be a guest on the podcast, but she declined. I get turned down a lot. I'm really okay with it. I'm still looking for someone that really can help me have a really in-depth conversation about friendship, because I think we all have a lot of friendship wounds. I just really enjoyed this episode with Anni. If you're interested in the podcast survey that I sent out, which you can also find at my website, a number of you said that you were interested in getting merchandise for the podcast, and we've got a ton of items. If you go to patriciayounglcsw.com, I have a store on that page, and we have lots of clothes and hats and masks and an apron and baby clothes and t-shirts. I think I said hoodies. All kinds of stuff. Some of it says unapologetically sensitive. Some of it says unapologetically sensitive podcast. There's a logo that I don't think anybody had seen. I actually forgot that I had it. That's a part of the overall logo. And I really like it. I ordered some stuff, some hats. If you're interested in getting merchandise, I'm pretty happy with the quality. We had a couple of samples that we got that we were not happy with. And so we pulled them from the store. So if you're interested, you can walk around being unapologetically sensitive. If you want to get in touch with me, you can reach me at unapologeticallysensitive@gmail.com. If you go to my website, all of my social media channels are there. I think that's all I have to say. I hope you are doing well. I hope you are having some joy, some peace. If you're having big feelings, it's part of being a highly sensitive person. I think that's all I have. Remember, sensitivity is nothing to apologize for. It's our superpower. Have a blessed day. Thank you.